left. Make it four as he hits the shots. 18 of limbs. 19 of limbs!
Two players left.
No! One. My gosh, Neo! 20! Don't do it!
Give
don't do
21.
It! He's got a family, Neo!
Oh, you got it.
For 21 and the victory royale!
Have a good time.
He did it! He won the game!
Team Gunny Gijo, Superior! The team's killing things at all.
I think
Superior! Pretty much Superior! Superior!
Edition of Esports in 30, because today is the day that I dress like Luigi. And we talk chicken dinners, victory royales, and arena jams, because it's Battle Royale Day, baby. I'm Marissa.
Hi, I'm Brody over here.
Yeah.
And since we're talking about more than one BR, I'll blame him for that terrible pun.
That
I brought in my resident 144Hz enthusiast, Zurich. Talk some BRs, man. You hype?
Yeah, I'm so hyped. We missed so much, like the past few months. So yeah. Many things has happened, so many moving parts, so many leagues, so many tournaments, so many player swaps.
It's true, and it's just unfortunate, sir, because you and I obviously do FPS Fridays all the time, mm-hmm. but we don't really give that much love to Battle Royales, first of all, because there's a lot to cover, and also because there are so many other amazing FPS games out there that we just have to cover them. We don't have time mm-hmm. for Battle Royale. Mm-hmm. It always takes a back burner, and I don't like that. So you know what? We gotta attack. We gotta get this going, but first, we're gonna put a little highlight piece to show you what's coming up. Enjoy.
SMG 파티인데요.
그렇죠. 아직까지 모였습니다.
토미건 두자루에 마이크로 오지.
토미야 오지.
그냥 들어가야지.
토미야 오지.
한 번. 그리고 오!
파이크! 파이크!
세븐! 큰 그림을 그렸는데 네 이게 지금 자 일단 남아있는
자 젠지가 동전 다 잡았죠?
네.
자 급하게 하면 안 돼요. 여기서부터. 급하게 하면 안 돼요.
오케이 오케이! 자
주원! 자 주원이 피워 눕혔는데 너무 많아요. 볼 때 너무
그렇죠.
많아요. 아, 자 오른쪽만 오른쪽만 그렇죠.
젠지 두 번째 매치에서 치킨을 가져가면서
the best players in NA East and Fortnite all going toe-to-toe. There goes the Boogie Bomb, but it's going to be blocked there for the moment. And then Vivid goes right back around to just get ownership of all of this terrain. Once again, it's something he does so well.
He has no builds. He has no builds, GB. He needs to be super careful here. Running around with Logar, picks up Spyrock as well.
What? That was disgusting! Morris thought that he was gonna catch Vivid with his pants down, but no, that belt was tied up nicely.
Burn through those 500 materials very, very quick.
Five players left. Make it four as he hits the shots. 18 of limbs. 19 of limbs!
Two players left.
No! One. My gosh, Neo! 20!
Give me 21.
Don't do it!
Give
Don't
me 21.
He's got a family, Neo!
Oh, you got it.
For 21 and the victory royale!
Did he get a gun?
He did it! He won the game! 20 eliminations and the win! A 30-point performance! He just popped off!
As you can see, a lot of things have already happened, so let's get up to speed with PUBG. As you heard in the highlights, there was a lot of Korean yelling, and for good reason, because the PUBG Korean League ended this week with Gen.G Esports taking the first place. But before we talk Gen.G, Zerk, what the heck is PKL?
yeah, that's a very good question, because PUBG's entire system is very similar to almost Dota-esque and like League of Legends style. So it's like they have regional, so they have kind of like the LEC and the LCS for the League of Legends side. They have like different regions. So like the Korean PUBG League is the PUBG Korean League, PKL.
There's so many letters in eSports.
There is a lot. And then the North American version is NPL. And then within those, they have like phases. So there's three phases per tournament, and within those phases there is international tournaments at the end of each phase, and then there's kind of like a money prize pool, very similar to the CSGO, like just big tournament prize pool.
Gotcha.
Doesn't affect any of the rankings style tournaments, which are called, I think, Royales. So there's a lot of things.
I saw you going through like the Wikipedia the other day for just like PUBG in general. I'm like, how many links? He's got like 20 tabs open trying to follow everything. I'm like, this is so
confusing. Is so many teams, so many players.
I mean, just on that, obviously because the players, it's a battle royale. Mm-hmm. So you have so many players on so many teams. Like, is this a good system or can they tighten it up to make it a little less confusing? And I feel like it's already hard to get into BR esports in general unless you're actively, as I said, had 20 Wikipedia, Liquipedia pages open. It's like, how do you keep up with this? Or is there a better system you can think of that they can come up with to like kind of streamline this for viewers?
Personally, I don't think so. The main, I mean, that's not even all of it. The craziest part is like they also have a contenders region as
well. That was just the first five pages that he had open.
Yeah, that's literally like the main, those are just the main leagues, and then they also have contenders, and then they have like, within those there's like relegation tournaments in between. It is so crazy to be a pro team in PUBG right now. There are so many things that you have to pay attention to. So many, just a lot of things.
Yeah, I guess it's just inherent with a BR, right? It's going to be confusing with more people.
Yeah.
You have to be fair to everyone to, you know, give them as many chances to, you know, win, make a name for themselves. So I think, yeah, you're right. You kind of need stuff like that. Mm-hmm. You can't do the traditional format of just a double elimination bracket or something. No, it just doesn't work.
Oh my gosh, no. Mm-hmm. Heck no.
No.
But we should talk about Gen.G here because obviously they were playing on a whole different level. So what stood out to you in this squad in particular for winning this phase two?
So pretty much winning phase two means that you get qualified, the top four teams gets qualified to their regional championships, which is called the MET Asia qualifiers, I think, or championships. Oh. And essentially, that's the end phase tournament that they hold, where whoever is the top two in that tournament already has a spot for the world championships.
Okay.
Yeah. They have like a lot more points, essentially. So they have a higher chance of making it all the way to the championships.
Okay, so they're already essentially in then.
Okay. The thing with the squad, though, is they are so much better than everybody else.
Like how though? Like, I feel like there's so many good players out there in PUBG. How is one team dominated? Like, is it just a strat or rotation? Are they just better at aiming? Like, what is it that?
Or do they not respect the rules of play and like go where they know other teams will drop?
Are they just playing dirty?
Yeah. Yeah. No,
What is it? Like,
this team is so specialized in a way where they are so mechanically sound. Everybody in the team can frag really well. Mm-hmm. So the heaviest part of their game style is always pushing into buildings or pushing into towns. They can take over like an entire town by themselves. They're very, very good utility usage, and all of them can aim. Their communication, I don't even know how it works. There's literally one match, I think it was week three on the second day, I think the third match, they won the game, but they're pushing this building, and two of their, I think Loki and Pio is like pushing into this building, and one of the Loki's tracking this guy going from one side of the fence to the other, and then he's tracking him, his crosshair's on him. He notices another guy to the right, and then he switches his crosshair to the right, shoots that guy, knocks him down. At the same time, obviously we can't hear their comms, but the guy that was on his left also gets down by his teammate that was behind him.
So he communicated like potentially like, hey, I'm tracking this guy, I see another guy, take first or whatever. Yeah.
Like they know to prioritize the targets, and like things like that are, it's so important for a very fast paced game, where especially in the super late game. So it's a very close, heavy team.
It's, like, it's always interesting hearing a team strats and wondering, how, okay, do they, what's the system they have? You know, is there a system that this player specifically always gets second sight? So say they see a second guy, you know, they'll tag them. Here's player one, player two, player three. Mm-hmm. I'll always take the higher number. So that way we know if the team sees three people, I'm taking the third one we saw. You're always going to take second. You're always taking first. So now they know, and they all can snap to the person they need to.
It is crazy like, it's to see it in like action, and it's so fast. In my mind, I'm just like, I don't understand how that entire interaction happened.
Down,
but for some reason, none of them get damaged. They wipe the entire opposing team, and they're just one of those teams.
But
they're
Sir,
so good.
Do you not ever think that, like, because you are good, I feel like you're just top tier. Like, you're good enough to play in
I'm
these
decent.
Things. No, you're very good. But do you feel like you just haven't found the right teammate then? Because all it really is communication. You have to have the skill for sure, 100, but you need to have comms with your team that unmatch really any other. So, do you maybe just haven't found the right people to play with? Maybe you should drop Brody.
It's because he keeps ghosting me, man.
He's
not inviting me. That's the problem here.
That's
I invite him, he logs off the game.
Yeah.
That actually happened.
Yeah, that actually happened.
You are guilty. That's maybe it's your fault, Derek. You don't like communicating with others.
Probably. But that's okay, because I like watching.
No, it's not okay, because you would be good enough to play in these leagues. We want to cheer for you, man.
I don't think so. I think I'd be too old already at this point. Anyway.
Yeah, okay, sure. Yeah, fine. We can switch over to the other side of the hemisphere. You mentioned MPL earlier, so I need to know what's happening with the NA side of things, because Tempo Storm was just dominant for so long. Are they still the best team in the region?
That team has the craziest, probably most exciting 2009 run so far.
2009?
We're going 2019. There. Sorry. My bad. Anyway, going
back
to
when
the...
Derek was born.
Yeah, back when I was born. No, I'm a 90s
Remember, he's
kid.
Old.
Yeah, I'm old. Anyway,
Tempo Storm.
Going to the end of this 2018 and late December, they were not really a contending team at all. And for some reason, along with like roster swaps, they had got a new coach. Coming into 2019, they just dominated phase one of the NPL. They completely swept the Royals, they swept. And then right after phase two, they were kind of around, this was around March, they kind of started losing to a bunch of the teams that were are very, very close to them, like Team Envy, who ended up winning the Royale, which is the midway tournament of phase two, where and in that tournament, Tempo Storm did not show up at all, and the entire scene was just like, is that it? It's kind of like what our Astralis is at the moment in the CSGO scene, where everybody is kind of just like, I guess that's it, Tempo Storm is done. Everybody has caught up with them, and that's it. You know, Team Envy and Cloud9 are probably the best team in NA. And then the finals happened last month, and Tempo Storm looked like pretty much the NA version of Genji.
Wow. That's,
so is it a similar playstyle then, or are we seeing differences in the regions, or is there a consistent meta that's being played across all the regions?
No, there is actually a very different meta, but the most interesting part is the meta isn't as, what do you call this, spread out, meaning some teams are very good at certain things, right? Because VR is very fluid, right?
Yeah.
So Tempo Storm is a team that's very, very good at rotation, very good at knowing, because the rule set now is all of the vehicle spawns are fixed.
Yes.
That's the new 2019 competitive rule set of PUBG, which they call the super rule set, and it stands for something like PUBG, I don't know. Anyway, so all the vehicle locations are preset now, and Tempo Storm, that is their main plan. They always have one or two cars, and the rest of them are usually looted. So what ends up happening, if you look at their stat sheet, is one or two of them has a lot of kills, and then the others are literally just backpacks.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're just driving like vehicles around, but it's like a different gameplay entirely.
Wow.
Super safe, super different, but it works out for them, and you know, now they won. They want
phase
two. Yeah,
well,
they are champions.
On that note, then, talking about vehicles, I just kind of want to talk about the game as a whole, because I've been obviously jumping around everywhere, focuses on Rocket League, and then when it comes to BRs, it's Apex for me right now. So with PUBG, I've seen some new things. There's a new vehicle, I think, as well. Can you just give us an update? What's the game look like? Have they fixed everything? Is it smooth to play now? Are they still having problems?
I actually pulled out a very, very good review, because I was like, I wonder what people are saying now after all the updates. Anyway, so here's what the review says.
Okay.
This game is like dating an alcoholic. They're a lot of fun to be around, and you legitimately like them. But they have serious problems. They ruin the whole relationship.
Yep.
You keep thinking they'll change, but they never will. Instead, they just try to sell you an event pass to see parts of their body. And that is literally what PUBG feels like. You love playing it. I love playing PUBG.
Yeah.
But every little things that just like, how did I get shot? I was in a, you know, like I'm hiding. How did I get shot? And the kill cam shows you and you're just like, I not even envision how did I get shot.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's so many hackers still. And it's always problem. Been it's always an issue be with, yeah. with you know, shooters like this consistently. And all the shooters, for some reason, PUBG seems like they're, anti-cheat system is really, really bad.
You're just not.
Okay.
Well, I feel like the core of a lot of the game, what it's based off, has some problems mm-hmm. too. So I wouldn't. I would be surprised, honestly, if they
Are
had a really good anti.
Are you playing the H1Z1? So,
what's this?
Are you playing the H1Z1?
No, I'm just. PUBG's I'm problems? Just saying they need to kind of go to the drawing board and fix it from the bottom up, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that's a bit of the problem. So I was just saying, I'd be surprised if they had a good anti-cheat system. Mm-hmm. To me, it being kind of like. Half working is like, yeah, that's PUBG. That makes sense.
It's good enough for now.
We all just like accept it because I still do think it is the best battle royale to watch, just bar none. It's so entertaining to just tune in and jump in for the weekend. Or there's so many different tournaments happening as well.
Every
week there's something because it is really that good. So if you haven't jumped into any battle royale yet to watch, please jump into this and not maybe the next one that we're going to talk about because they just have a lot to work out here. And yes, of course, I am talking about Fortnite. I know Brody loves Fortnite so much. So we've missed actually 10 weeks of qualifiers. In Fortnite, 10 freaking weeks because that's how much love we give Fortnite over here. So Zerk, can you just give us a TLDR, please?
Yeah. 10 weeks is a long time. a very long TLDR. But essentially, there was an online qualifying circuit where the pros get to queue up with each other, and it's the same thing as PUBG. Points are gained by kills and placements, but in their system, it's solos and duos only. So it's not four-man squads. But there's two different tournaments. And the system pretty much just you queue up within a three-hour period where that competitive server is alive. You play 10 matches max, and you have to score as many points within that 10 matches. And it's just like you keep playing like that until you have the leaderboard. We have already, most of the big names in there. We have Vivid in who already qualified, I think, in week one. You know, Tfue week two. Ninja, I think, is also qualified, I think, but like he got qualified a little bit later. So everybody is there in solos and duos. Mm. There's so many names that I'm just like, who the heck is this guy?
That's the inherent thing with an open system. And they do it in the game though, the way they do this.
It's not integrated.
Like it's kind of cool, to be honest, that there isn't a separate site like I have to go like Battlefy
register,
and stuff,
and
register,
then,
sign up, and then do it. It's just in the game, the servers are live, click play and go.
Well, you have to be part
cool.
of like the Epic community. Like you've had to give them all your information anyway to play. Mm-hmm. So it's already all locked in, so why not jump in and try?
It's just nice to have a system built in there that you just jump in and play. But of course, because of that, you're gonna have all these names you don't know, right? Because there's keyboard warriors or bedroom warriors, we call them, because they're at home in their environment and they can just send it, It changes when they get to a live environment, but at home, these guys can just pop off sometimes. So like this tournament, are there any specific names you didn't know before that now you know, or is it just a mishmash?
There is a lot. Like almost every week, the person who takes one of the highest points are always like, except for like the first few weeks where obviously like the top players showed up, the rest of the weeks I'm just like, I don't know who this guy is. Also have to keep in mind that the original the opening qualifiers was an open qualifiers, meaning anybody could join it, and all you had to do was like keep winning, keep gaining points and make it to the top whatever I think it was top 200 players. And then from there, they like grab the point. Wow. It's crazy.
So there is a system in place and it seems to be working then. So where do you see the future of this going? Could Fortnite actually be a legitimate battle royale esport? Could it actually usurp PUBG? Could we actually, Brody's face, no. But it could
be. They said themselves no. Really?
No, but like it could legitimately be fun to watch because now we also have, like, I'm jumping ahead a little bit here, but there are these creative mods now where people are just creating different levels that they can play in. There's different modes for people to play, changing the meta completely for Fortnite. So there's so many different options here for players to actually shine. So why couldn't it be?
So that's actually part of the World Cup as well, the creative side of it. So if you get part of the 30 million prize pool, I think, for the entire like thing, but I don't know how much of that portion is actually going to be put into the creative mode. Anyway, you play 5 maps created by some of the top players top creators in the Fortnite community. They make like little speedrunning and stuff like that, as you said.
Yeah.
I think Fortnite as a BR has less of a chance of succeeding.
Oh.
Compared to their creative mode.
Oh, okay.
I think the creative mode is like is kind of like Minecraft in a way, but like there is something about it that could be potentially competitive. Do you know what I mean?
Mm. Well, it also feels like I think it falls in line with Epic's vision a bit more too, with what Fortnite is. Fortnite is,
it's broader.
It's an entertainment, and that's why I said they themselves have said no, this isn't a serious esport, and they've warned the pros about that this is something that we do to create entertainment for, and having a creative modes like that kind of take that forefront would not surprise me at all, because it's just exactly what Epic's vision is, I think.
And going back to Epic's vision, maybe a few months ago they added a patch that gave everybody kind of like lifesteal. So every time you got a kill, the siphon system. Well, the pros liked it because you can be more aggressive and stuff like that. But 97% of the population absolutely hated it because they hated just walking around getting like destroyed by somebody who's a little bit better than them, who has 200 HP and shield, right?
Well, that's the thing,
and that's
something that the pros have been wanting for a while. Just like they also, like, I mean, really, they need their own servers if we're just being real about this. Like, and that would be very entertaining to watch instead of having to like, I can't jump into any of this and expect to make it anywhere fast. Yeah, it's too late. So let the pros shine, give them their own servers. But I mean, Epic has, like, they face a lot of criticism, obviously, from Brody mostly, but they face a lot of criticism. I feel like they've cleaned it up. I honestly do. Since 2018, I feel like they've cleaned it up.
Well, let's you know, take some more criticism from me and say, let's talk about a real BR. How about that? Let's move on, because I want to talk about Apex right now.
Yes. Okay.
There's so much going on at Apex. This one is popping off. They had everyone jumped on this right away. It surprised, I think, even the devs right away. Respawn was surprised. And then it sunk down a bit, because people weren't too happy right away with their first season pass. But the whole new one's out here. There's a bunch of new stuff. Can you just lay out the land of what we're seeing in season two?
It is so good. They changed the map, so now it's a little bit different. I really like how it's kind of like the Fortnite style of map creation instead of the PUBG style, where it's like, instead of releasing new maps, it's a lot more, you know, we're going to kind of change the map a little bit, and then you kind of have to relearn it. It's still similar, but it's like, you kind of have to relearn it. So something about that system I really much prefer than like the PUBG. This is a whole new map, you have to relearn it. And speaking of their battle pass, holy guacamole, that new battle pass is so good. I understand from like Respawn's development point, it's so hard to design character costumes for characters that are pretty stale. Like, they just look like generic military dudes, right?
Yeah.
Whereas in Fortnite, like, you can literally put them in anything. For some reason, it makes sense, right?
Yeah.
So Apex has this issue, which I think was a lot, like, what was the main issue for their main battle pass that a lot of people kind of overlooked on, but now they did such a good job, so many cool skins.
There are some crazy skins.
Yes.
Absolutely. I know. They just really spiced it up. They made it look so much more enjoyable, so much more exciting to play. But I do want to talk about this ranking system that they've added. Because I know it's supposed to be super exciting. The whole office knows that you're obsessed with ranking systems, Zerg. So I need to know your thoughts on this.
I love it. So the system works by you pretty much getting RP or rank points per kills and also placements. So whenever you gain the currency, we're gonna call it a currency, and I'll explain why in a second. To rank up, you have to use a certain amount of RP. Mm-hmm. Meaning, if you're a bronze player, you can play for free as many times as you want. You get RP, you get 100 RP, you can unlock the gold queue.
So you can queue with people that have unlocked.
Yes, but then on the gold queue, each queue costs 2 RP. But so that means.
So to stay at that rank, you have to do good.
Yeah, but you can't lose that rank that you already unlocked. So it's not that bad. It's just it's harder to gain points the higher you go, right? So the not only is it super high stakes because you could potentially lose. If you kept losing like 10 games in a row, you'd lose a lot of your points, right?
Yeah. So this is just like the Clash Royale model.
Is that how it works? I'm not sure.
So basically,
yeah, you get points and you get to level up and then you play people that are at that level. You can't dip below that level. You can't dip below once you've reached that max, right? Mm-hmm. But you have to still accrue more points in, within that level.
But the stakes, like the gambling part of it is not part of it.
Yeah, because it's like if you need more points, you have to go back down to the bronze queue to get the points.
No, you can't. You're stuck in the diamond.
I think you had to go back down. Okay.
No, but that's the thing.
I jumped in to play the other day because I just wanted to, you know, chill. I didn't jump into the ranked yet. I'm gonna have to go in and get
it's a full very good. I think it's the first system that could potentially actually work in a battle royale.
Yeah, I want to try. I just jumped in because I want to play with Watson, but I couldn't. I didn't have her unlocked yet. But she's the newest character, and I think you've been playing with her.
Yes.
So talk to me. What she does? What does she change? Because they put her in there to give people new playstyle options, right? So what does she do?
So she's very kind of like anti-CC slash bunker.
Yeah.
It's a very, very different character compared to everybody else. Because Apex, most of the characters are a lot more like, you know, let's push.
It's
like,
aggro. It's very,
very aggro.
Like
Wraith, like Octane, for example. But Watson is the very first character that's similar to Caustic and Gibraltar, where a lot of her skill sets is very... it's like specialized to controlling a zone. Her traps are so cool. So most of the time and in most of the trails, they showed it kind of like, you know, you control a perimeter and stuff like that. But I mostly use it going around corners, because if you could, you can place a fence like across the door, right? As somebody's following you, and then place the second one to complete the wall as they're crossing, so that they can't see you. It kind of works like a flashbang slash CC. And but the coolest part about her is she does not feel like a regular, as we said already, a regular Apex character. So it's a very backpack heavy. You have to carry a lot of ultimate accelerants because you need your ult for every single fight.
No, like you're giving the accelerants to her for sure, hands down.
So cool though.
Okay,
so
we need to talk about the fact this game also did a really great job of just transitioning through patches. Like originally only having a few guns for new players, right? And they have to just learn how to deal with it. But now they're slowly expanding. I mean, there's like a new gun as well that maybe we can talk
about. Actually, I got a story for that.
Okay. I'll start
and a very sad story.
Okay.
Because I dropped in, I only played a couple matches because I was warming up. I dropped in, and I'm like, I wasn't even thinking about getting the L-Star because I'm like, it's hard to get that, right?
Yeah.
Like, get the drop.
It's rare.
But we dropped in, and I started just getting reamed on, like, instantly. I'm like, why am I dying so quick? So I hid, eventually killed the guy shooting at me. He had the L-Star. He was just destroying me with it. I picked it up. I'm like, yeah, I get to use it. And two teams came in and killed me. And all my teammates were dead, too. So I got to hold it for a minute. Mm-hmm. I didn't get to use it.
Yes.
But wait, with the L-Star, like, did they know that you had it? Can you see it on the map somewhere? Is it in your HUD at all? Like, can you see it in someone else?
No, somebody's holding it, you can see it.
Yeah. I only knew it was there because the gold crate. And that was the only reason. So you've probably gotten to use it.
I actually have.
That's what I'm saying. It's hard. It's elusive. It is elusive.
Yeah, it's a very rare gun.
I was so sad when that happened to me. So since I didn't get to use it, tell me what it does.
So essentially, it's a an energy LMG, which is the past guns like the carbine. It's kind of like a rifle slash submachine gun in between. So it's a very unique gun. It's literally it's its own style at the moment. It's the only light machine gun energy ammo type of gun, but it is so rare because it's so strong.
It rips. That's why I said it's
pretty much an insta give.
I actually had no clue how I was dying so quick, and that's why it is. I want to get my hands
on
it.
It's not because he's not good.
No,
I survived. That means I was good enough.
It's too pretty. Yeah. Anyway, you've got to go. Okay, listen, that's it. It's the end of our show. Thank you so much to Zurich for dropping by and dropping that VR knowledge on us. You know we need it. Thank you at home for tuning in. Thanks, I guess, to Brody, too. Next week, we're back with more Squad. Until then, hit us up on all our socials at Squad State and have an amazing weekend.